Hey everybody, Bob Rasooli, Orange County, California. Welcome to the I4I Academy. If you're planning to take the API 510 Pressure Vessel Inspection Certification exam, I have a prep course for you. This is an online video training, and it's not a boring PowerPoint presentation with some voiceover. It's a real me in the classroom with this pressure vessel, that test coupon. Besides, I'm having an imaginary pressure vessel with this 60-inch inside diameter, 900 psi design pressure, and 700 degree Fahrenheit design temperature, which is going to give us a pressure vessel with this 3-inch wall thickness. So we're going to have these things, and also we're going to consider that the surface of this pressure vessel is going to be a toxic substance, which is in the ASME, we name it the lethal surfaces. And then you're going to see most of the requirement of the ASME code is going to be implied on this example pressure vessel. What we're going to do, we're going to go through all the segment of the ASME Section 8 Division 1. And for example, we're going to review this imaginary pressure vessel and to see how those rules and requirements and prohibitions imply on this pressure vessel. The experience showed us when you are teaching with the example, the people comprehend it's easier. That's why this pressure vessel is going to follow us in the whole process. So we're going to start with the ASME Section 8 Division 1, then we're going to go to the Section 9, and then we're going to go to the Section 5, and then API 510, and some other codes also is here, like a 572, 577, 576, these are the self-explanatory. We're not going to have a video for those segments, but we're going to have hundreds of the exam questions, which is going to come and cover those segments. So our video parts only covers the part that is complicated to understand. So we're going to have a video training, and that's the rest actually is going to be practicing with the exam question. For pressure vessel part, we're going to start with the pressure vessel manufacturer, certificate of authorization, what's the national board inspection code, what's the authorized inspection agency, and then we're going to move to the material. What is the material requirement for a pressure vessel? We're going to see what is the ASTM material, what is the ASME material, what is the European material. Can we use the ASTM and European material for ASME pressure vessel? We're going to discuss those things and going to see what's requirements implies to our imaginary pressure vessel. Then we're going to move to the design phase. So in a design phase, we're going to cover all the design items that came in the API 510 body of knowledge, calculation the wall thickness through the inside diameter, or some a little calculation for static heads, and also considering the static head for calculation of the wall thickness, reinforcement pads, and stuff like that is going to be covered on a design segment. Then we're going to go to the fabrication part of the ASME Section 8 Division 1 to see what is the joint category, what is the weld type, category A, category B, category C, category D, and the weld type number 1 through the 7 and 8, and to see how the ASME makes the rules and requirement and prohibitions based off these joints and weld types. And we're going to also review the special services, like this one, which is going to be contain a toxic substance or lethal services, to see what kind of requirement is going to apply to us. I mean, we're not going to be able to use any joints that is allowed for the other pressure vessel because of the service or a category or weld type combination. All of them, these things is going to be considered. Like a PWHT, post weld heat treatment, full radiography is going to be mandatory requirement for our pressure vessel for a different reason, for wall thickness, for a service. All of these things is going to be reviewed and considered for this training course and this video training course. And then when we reviewed all the requirement, and then we're going to consider our own pressure vessel and move on impact testing. There's a 4-step we normally review and assess to see our pressure vessel can be exempted from the impact testing. As a general, we're going to review all the requirements and prohibitions, and then we're going to consider our imaginary pressure vessel to see if our pressure vessel with a 3-inch wall thickness and the specified minimum design middle temperature can be exempted from the impact testing. By the way, it's not going to get exempted. We're going to go all four steps and see we can't get exempted, and we're going to perform the impact testing. Then we're going to review to see what's the requirement to perform the impact testing, how many specimens we need, what's the acceptance criteria, should we do on the weld or we're just doing them in the material, what's going to happen if the plate manufacturer already performed the impact testing. All of them is going to be reviewed on impact testing segment, and then we're going to move forward with the post-weld heat treatment requirement. So when the post-weld heat treatment becomes a mandatory requirement in the perishable vessel, we're going to review them, wall thickness, service, and other stuff. And now if we are going to perform post-weld heat treatment, what is the requirement? Holding time and heating rate, cooling rate, and then difference in a different thermometer temperature when the perishable vessel is in the heating rate or it is on the furnace for heat treatment. All of them is going to be reviewed, which is they are all the subject to the exam questions. And then after we finish the post-weld heat treatment, we're going to move on the inspection and testing based of the ASME Section 8 Division 1. What is the full radiography? What is the spot radiography? What is their requirement? What is their prohibitions? And then liquid penetrant testing and magnetic particle testing. What is the qualification of the NDE personnel? All of them is going to be reviewed. All of them is in the body of knowledge of the API 510 examination. And then after we completed the inspection and testing and also hydrostatic testing and pneumatic testing requirement, and then we're going to go to see what is the manufacturer data report requirement and the marking requirement. When we completed the ASME Section 8 Division 1, you're going to log on the, our exam portal, and there are going to be almost 300 exam questions about the ASME Section 8 Division 1. Totally, we are having a 1,000 exam question, even more than 1,000 exam question for the whole API 510. But after finishing each segment, you can go and log on the portal and take the exam for that portion. So we didn't mix them up. So they are separate, the Section 8, Section 9, Section 5, and then we are having a practice exam, which is the mixed up, which is going to be simulate the API exam for a closed book section and for open book segment. When we finish the Section 8, we move to the Section 9. We're going to review what is the, you know, all the definition in the ASME Section 9, like what is the P number, what is the F number, what is the A number, what is the essential variables, what is the non-essential variables, what is the supplementary essential variables, what is the mechanical testing we have to perform for qualification of the PQR. We're going to have a example WPS and PQR for our imaginary perishable vessel with the 3-inch wall thickness. When the impact testing is not required, when the impact testing is required, how we're going to qualify that, and then the same things for a welder performance qualification or welding operator qualification. So we're going to cover all the ASME Section 9, all the segments that they covered in the body of knowledge we're going to cover, and then you are going to have log on to our portal, and again there is a more than 200 exam question over there in the closed book part and open book part. You're going to have the 5 sample WPS and PQR with the lots of wrong things inside, and you're going to ask to verify those item through the 50 question to find the what is the wrong with that things on WPS and PQR, and make you practice back and forth. You might need to go back to the videos, come back, and also you're going to have a handout to verify these things. And then you completed the Section 9, we go to the Section 5 to see what is the NDE requirement. Similarly, we're going to cover that, and there's a separate exam in our portal for ASME Section 5. So when you finish the ASME part, you're going to start the API part. API part, you know, starts with the API 510 and 572. It is a major. You know, these are the self-explanatory things. We are having a video segment for API 10 for solving the problem. What I'm going to ask you when you having this training course with me, that you go and review the API 510, read the API 510 even once. I mean, if even the cursory doesn't matter, then you're going to come to the video and you know, going to have a lots of problem to solve together, like how to calculate the corrosion rate, long term, short term, how to calculate remaining life, how to use those tables to determine inspection interval, how to calculate MAWP to confirm inspection interval. All of them is going to be video for them, and then when you completed those videos and also you reviewed the ASME section 5, API 510, then you're going to go to the logon on the portal, and there's hundreds of the exam questions about the solving the problem and also the closed book kind of exam questions. 572 is a kind of a self-explanatory, like a 576 the same way, 577. You're going to have hundreds of the exam questions taken from those you know, recommended practice on our portal. So cumulatively, we're going to have almost 1,000. We're going to have a separate exam for each of these things, which is in the body of knowledge, and then a practice exam, actually, which is the mix-up of this exam question. So it's an almost 60-hour video training program, 22 hours almost it's a video, and the rest is going to be the practice you're going to do through the handout and also through the exam questions and prepare yourself for a API exam. What are we gonna do in here? We're gonna have a final exam just for your certification purpose. If you pass that exam, it's a 150 question, 50 open book, 100 closed, but similar to the API exam, then you're gonna get another, you know, you can get a certificate from the I4I Academy with my signature, which is gonna credit you for a 60-hour training, which is related to the prep course for API 510 exam. I put it in here some, you know, hour or more than hour of a sample of the videos that we are having for API 510 exam. You can watch them, and also I'm going to provide you the access to go to the portal and to see some of those exam questions and to see how they are working. So I mean, it's an interactive coursing between the videos and those exam questions. I never use the PowerPoint presentation with the voiceover, which is very common. Those are very boring, it's ineffective, but I rather prefer to come over here in front of the camera to provide the prep course in front of the camera, which is gonna be similar to my other, you know, the classes. So this was about our API 510, and it's, I'm sure this is going to take you to the next level. If you take this course, I have no doubt that you're going to pass the API 510 certification exam. Thank you for your attention.